Ernst Gombrich was a great art historian, the greatest of several generations, and I was very fortunate to know Ernst. He was the grand old man, very, very formidable, and we did this exhibition together at the ICA, Institute of Contemporary Arts, and we did a book together, Illusion in Nature and Art, and I knew him for, I suppose, the last 10 years of his life, a bit more than that, 15 years perhaps. And I used to often pop in and see him. He was extraordinary because he was a tremendous expert, of course, in art itself, and his books are widely, widely read. But he also knew a lot about perception, and he's one of the very few experts in art that I know of who actually bother about what goes on in the mind or in the brain or how they work. Now, to my mind, not having any feel for that is like a violinist not knowing that a violin has strings or that a violin has resonances. And surely what art is really doing is playing on the resonances of the mind with, through brain mechanisms. So you need to know the strings and the resonances, the physiology and the software of the brain and the mind, really, to understand art. And I would have thought to practice it explicitly. And that raises a very interesting question, that if an artist thinks too much, it maybe they get put off, that they have to do it perhaps intuitively, implicitly, and when it becomes explicit and they actually think what they're doing, maybe the skill breaks down. And this is true of many things. If you try and run upstairs fast, thinking about each foot as you put it onto the treads of a staircase, you fall over or you go very slowly. Consciousness gets in the way. And I really wonder, you know, whether consciousness gets in the way of art, whether it needs to be implicit, non-academic. And it may be that the academic approach, which was certainly Gombrich's, actually destroys creativity in art. It's a very interesting question.
Mm-hmm. It is. And how did Gombrich inform you? I mean, thinking about his knowledge in art, how did it inform your knowledge of perception?
Well, we worked very, very closely. I think in a way, I don't want to be, you know, push it too far, but I think he was actually a little bit influenced by my views of perception. But how far he'd already thought of them, you know, perhaps 30 years before, because he's older than me, and how far he was actually sort of following what I was trying to say, I never knew, really. Mm-hmm. And of course, he was extremely urbane, civilised man. He would never sort of say, oh, I thought of that before, sort of thing, you know. He wasn't like that at all. But all I can say is that talking about resonance, we resonated. I mean, he was a much better scholar than me. I had infinite respect for him in every way, you know, and I felt like a sort of junior member of the tribe in many ways. But at the same time, that exhibition was actually rather based on stuff that I'd written and done. So it was a jolly good collaboration. Though I always deferred to Ernst, really, as the senior partner.